Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edisset Live Lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on Indian political thought, we have been thinking and we have been conducting lectures on the political thoughts of various thinkers. Today, dear friends, we would be talking on political thoughts of Raja Rammohun Roy. And for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Dr. Satish Kumar Jha. Dr. Satish Kumar Jha is Associate Professor in Aryabhatta College, University of Delhi. Dr. Jha has immense experience, and let's welcome our guest, Dr. Satish Kumar Jha, and let's try to understand the political thought of Raja Rammohun Roy. Hello, sir. Welcome to the Edisset Lecture.
Thank you. Good afternoon. In fact, today's lecture we are going to devote on political thought of Rammohun Roy, popularly known as Raja Rammohun Roy. And interestingly, this title of Raja was given to him by the titular Mughal emperor when he was going to England to defend the legislation on Sati, and this title was given to him for espousing the cause of the emperor before the British king. So this is how he came to be known and became popular as Raja Rammohun Roy. But there are few things which are very significant about him, about his ideas, about his thought, and his contribution to modern Indian political thinking, as well as for making India modern. And it is therefore, not without chance that Rammohun Roy is known as father of modern India. In fact, for example, when it comes to the fatherhood, there is father of nation, there is father of parliamentary democracy, but there is father also of Indian modernity, the father of modern India. Now, first of all, when we say that he was the father of modern India, a few questions can be asked, why he is given this distinction that he is father of modern India. In 1933, in the centenary year of his death, many speakers like Tagore, Radhakrishnan, Bipin Chandra Pal spoke of him as father of modern India in a gathering. In Calcutta. So therefore, even such great luminaries acknowledged him as father of modern India. But from the point of view of political thought, what normally we know that he is remembered as father of modern India largely on account of the fact that he inaugurated the age of enlightenment and liberal reformist modernization in India. He drew on his knowledge of Perso-Arabic, classical Greek, Vedantic and Western modern political thought, modern thought of Europe, particularly England and other places. And by getting exposed to these ideas, he realized the limitation of Indian society, realized the limitation of Hinduism, realized the limitation of evil practices in Indian society, and therefore took on them and basically spearheaded a campaign. And apart from the social and religious reforms which he initiated, which he helped the then British government to legislate, he also espoused the cause of modern English education in India. And this is perhaps very significant from the point of view of calling him the father of modern India, because Indian modernity, it is believed, started with modern English education, because it initiated number of changes in Indian society, particularly the kind of knowledge system which it brought here, based on enlightenment reasoning, basically, and the modern sensibility. That was the beginning of Indian enlightenment, and therefore it was the beginning of modern India. That is 1835, introduction of English education. We will basically discuss this aspect later, that how he is considered to be the architect of modern education in India. Of course, there are, contrarian points of view also. Many nationalist leaders didn't agree with Rammohun and his entire quest for modern English education. Rather, they believed that it was the kind of, process or the kind of development which led to Indian servitude, because earlier India had lost political freedom, India had lost economic freedom, but with modern English education, India also lost its intellectual freedom, cultural and civilizational autonomy, and therefore it was not the beginning of modernity, rather it was the beginning of new servitude, new slavery and new enslavement. So this is there, that debate is there. We will basically take up this issue later. What we are basically, we are concerned at the moment that why he is remembered as father of modern India, and it is on account of the fact that his enlightenment, thinking, his entire quest to reform society and religion, and particularly his entire endeavor, his entire attempt to bring modern English education, he is remembered as father of modern India. As I told you that he was very erudite, he had studied many, languages. As much as 10 languages he had mastered. In fact, he had immense knowledge of Perso-Arabic, classical Greek, the Vedantic and Western political thought. In fact, he was not only admired in India for his entire crusade against Sati system, his entire crusade for the widow remarriage, but even someone as, eminent as Jeremy Bentham, the British political philosopher and theorist, even he admired him, and he, when he wrote to Rammohun, he said that dearly beloved collaborator in the service of mankind, particularly his crusade against religion and crusade against society, Bentham also acknowledged when he called him dearly beloved collaborator in the service of mankind. So therefore, this is how he came to be known, not only in India but outside also, as a great crusader, as a great, votary and champion of social and religious reform. Before we, move on to the other dimensions of his political thought, as it is, it is important in case of any political thinker to know his life, his basically, his entire career, education and so on and so forth, because there is a sociology of knowledge, that what type of knowledge one attained, what kind of social situation one was placed in. So this is very important methodological issue in any in any analysis of any political thinker. So in fact, in case of Rammohun Roy, his life, he was born on 22nd May 1772, in fact in an orthodox Brahmin family in Bengal, in fact in a place called Radhanagar. In fact, his father was Ramakant Roy, who was a revenue officer and also a landlord in his own right under the Maharani of Mardavan. So this is his background. Coming from a landlord family, from the upper caste, upper class background, Rammohun also was basically brought up in a family which believed in orthodox Hinduism. So therefore, in fact, this kind of religious and social background Rammohun had. So, for his early education is concerned, in fact, he has studied different languages, he has studied different, issues pertaining to philosophy, religion, society and so on and so forth. The early education of Rammohun included the study of Persian and Arabic at Patna, which was at that point of time a center of learning so far as the Arabic and the Persian were concerned. He also read Quran, he also had access to the works of Sufi mystic poets of Persia and Arabia. In fact, he also got the opportunity to study the translation of Plato and Aristotle, particularly in these languages, particularly in Persian and Arabic. After his Patna sojourn, he went to Banaras, where he studied Sanskrit, ancient Hindu scriptures like Vedas and Upanishad. And after attaining these this study, he returned to his village and wrote a rational critique of the Hindu idol worship. And this was the issue which basically angered his father. Rather, he was displeased by this kind of, blasphemous act of his son. And therefore, Rammohun had to leave his village and his family, and he took to wanderings and went as far as Tibet and studied Buddhism. So therefore, one can see that how he studied not only Hinduism, but he studied Islam, he studied Buddhism, and later on also Christianity. So therefore, he studied four important religions and could do a comparative study of all of them. And therefore, when he talked of religious reform, he was speaking from the point of view of all religion, not one religion. And therefore, he basically also pointed out the similarities in all religions, and therefore also the evil practices. And therefore, his entire crusade for religious reform was basically on account of the fact that he considered that all religions talk of one similar thing, but then there are intermediaries, there are number of channels through which they have been distorted over the years. So therefore, this is how we can see that how his education was important so far his politics is concerned, particularly politics of reform. And therefore, it is not just a chance that Rammohun at times is also compared with Luther, particularly his entire reformist zeal within Christianity. The way Luther basically tried to reform Christianity, many people believe that Rammohun tried to reform Hinduism. So therefore, this entire thing was the result of, or basically the offshoot of, his access to different knowledge system, different scriptures, different religious discourses, and so on and so forth. Now, after having seen that what type of education he got, it is also important to remember that Rammohun also had a career in East India Company. In fact, 1803 to 1814, he worked for the East India Company as a personal Diwan of Digby, and later in 1814, he resigned his job and devoted his full time to the issue of reforms, because he thought that it was a better service to humanity than serving just the East India Company. Now, with this background, one has to see that what type of writings he could produce in his lifetime, because Rammohun was a prolific writer. In fact, he wrote so many discourses, so many tracts, which have come down to us till today as important source to see that how, what kind of social churning was taking place in India around that time. And some of the writings can be basically identified, particularly the writings which are considered to be important to understand Rammohun's political thought. For example, the first important writings we find in 1813, Tuhafatul Muhauddin. This is basically the gift of the deist. In fact, this is a famous piece of writing by Rammohun. Of course, in 1850, he also wrote Vedant Granth. He also in 1850 wrote Vedant Shastra. In 1870, Kathopanishad. In 1816, Ishopanishad. And then, of course, important tract called The Precepts of Jesus. Because later on, when he studied Christianity, and he believed that, the kind of wrong practices which have plagued most of the religions, Christianity is also not immune from them. And therefore, the way Jesus was turned into a god, in fact, he said that there is a problem there. Particularly, he was a great admirer of a book called Sermon on the Mount, and he said that the kind of morality, kind of ethics, kind of values which Jesus preached, something to emulate. So therefore, The Precepts of Jesus is also another important piece of writing by Rammohun. Then the Tracts on Religious Toleration in 1823. And finally, and perhaps the most significant piece of writing was Letter to the Lord Amherst, 1829. As I was mentioning, that he is considered as the architect of modern English education in India. And modern English education was introduced in 1835 by Macaulay's Minutes. The law member in Viceroy's Executive Council. And that was responsible for initiating this entire modern English education in India, on basis of which today's universities and colleges and schools function. But it was basically this Letter to Lord Amherst in 1829, which became the basis for 1835 Minutes of Macaulay. We'll basically turn to this issue later in our discussion, that how this letter is significant. Because whatever Rammohun wrote in 1829 letter, we find that Macaulay's Minutes to great extent translate those ideas into practice through his famous minutes. So this is how we can have an idea about Rammohun's writings. Now coming to the influences on Rammohun, there were many influences on Rammohun. For example, the influences of Western political thought, of course, were immense, which he basically got through his reading of these great thinkers, as well as through his association with some functionaries of East India Company. In fact, one important influence, as I mentioned, was also Bentham, who also admired him for his crusade against social evils and religious practices. Other influences were the influence writings of Locke, Hume, Bentham, and Christian Unitarians. 1830, in fact, he also sailed to England to counter the nullification of sati banning legislation, because there was an attempt to nullify the 1829 legislation of Bentinck to ban sati, and therefore he went 1830 to England to just create a public opinion against that move, and therefore tried to nullify that attempt, and therefore in fact this 1830 journey to England is also quite significant in his life. In fact, I mentioned earlier that the title of Raja was given to him by the titular Mughal emperor when he was going to England, because the emperor thought that he would defend his case before the king. 1833, in fact, he died in England, in Bristol, and therefore that was the end of such an illustrious career of Rammohun. Now, his entire intellectual, social and political journey, Rammohun also founded many associations, and some of the associations became the main forum, the main channel through which he channelized his entire energy, his entire attempt to bring changes in society. And in this connection, one finds that the most important associations which he founded was, of course, Atmiya Sabha in 1815, the Calcutta Unitarian Assembly in 1821, and the Brahmo Samaj, Brahmo Sabha, which later became Brahmo Samaj in 1828. Even a political association which he founded, which later on became the Zamindars, Indian Zamindars Association. So therefore, these are some of the important associations we find in name of Rammohun. Now, coming to his entire political thought, one thing is very significant. In fact, that is his entire concern for social and religious thought. Basically, he didn't make a distinction between religious and social thought. He thought that in India, the religious practices and the social practices were both feeding into each other, and therefore the two reforms basically he wanted to initiate. There are many scholars who try to make a distinction between Indian social religious reform movement and the religious reform movement of Europe. Even they make a distinction between the Enlightenment and the social religious reform movement in England, in Europe. They believe that they were separated by 100 years. Renaissance and social religious reform movement were separated by 100 years. But in India, they believe that both coincided, because both came roughly at the same time. And this social religious reform movement, in fact, Rammohun is credited for initiating this practice. Of course, earlier we have seen that there are many attempts in the civil society to raise the voices against these things. We are familiar that how the Sufism and the Bhakti movement in the medieval period were the first flag bearer of reform movement. But in fact, this concerted attempt in the modern times, with the modern sensibility, with a kind of plea to the state power and the state institutions and the authorities to legislate on these issues, because as it is commonly known that one of the weakest link of the Mughal Empire, particularly the great visionary Emperor Akbar, was his inability to legislate on the social matters. He rather didn't interfere in the social matter. Initially, even Britishers were trying to keep their hands off the social religious matters. But it was largely on account of the fact that people like Rammohun brought pressure, created a kind of public opinion in the society, took on the orthodox conservative elements, and the Britishers were compelled to basically move in direction of not only legislating, but keeping or taking keen interest in social and religious reform movement. And therefore, the initial phase, therefore a lot of people believe that Rammohun's engagement with Indian nationalism was weak. But one should also remember that how the social religious reform movement became the basis for Indian nationhood, how it became the basis for Indian nationalism. So therefore, of course, it is true that Rammohun didn't attack British colonial rule the way the subsequent nationalists did. In fact, he also endorsed India's economic linkages with the British, imperialism and the British economy. It is also true that he considered British rule as to be the gift of the God. But there were reasons for that. We'll come to these issues when we will discuss his political views. But so far the social and religious issues are concerned, they are very significant from the point of view of Rammohun's political thought. Now, of course, immediate concern of Rammohun was the degeneration of his native Bengal, because it is, after all, the surroundings in which one is placed that his or her political thought is largely shaped. And in Rammohun's case, his entire political thought was shaped by his own surroundings, that was his native Bengal. In fact, when he took up this issue of sati, he could see in his own family his kith and kin being, pushed on the funeral pyre, and therefore he could see the degraded status of women in India. And therefore he believed that unless this type of evil practice is banned and eradicated from Indian society, there is no future. There is no, a hope for any further progress of Indian people and Indian society. Now, the first book which he penned, that was Tawafat-e-ul Muawuddin, The Gift of Deists. In fact, this book itself singles out some of these degenerated practices, some of these degenerations. In fact, Rammohun not only attacked orthodox Hindu practices like bathing in river, worshipping trees, becoming monks, and adoring priesthood, and so on and so forth. He attacked the priestly class as a whole as a great kind of bias which Indian religion, Hinduism, as well as Indian society are bearing with. In fact, this type of diagnosis of the evils of the religion led him to both religious reform and the social reform. Now, in fact, one thing is important to remember, that he conceived of religious reform, as an instrument of social and political transformation and awakening in India. And therefore, we find that social and religious reform occupies importance in his political thought. What we find that, he wanted to end the monopoly of the Brahmins over the sacred text. And he believed that unless that monopoly is basically finished, there is no hope left for the Indian people, because it is their monopoly on these texts which is leading to this wrong interpretation. And he believed that there is no scope for any intermediaries in any religion, because every human being is endowed with this, this innate capacity to reflect, to understand, and to basically make sense of what these scriptures say. And therefore, because of their ignorance, these intermediaries, the priestly class of all religions, basically exploit them. And therefore, he wanted to make available all these tracts, all these discourses of religion in basically people's language. Therefore, he decided to translate most of these scriptures in vernacular languages, in Bangla, in Hindi, of course he did in English and Persian, Arabic, because he thought that if they are translated, it would be accessible to Indian people, and then perhaps they could see that what is basically the essence of the religion. They could see that how that has been distorted. They could see that how these intermediaries, the priestly class, has been responsible for gross misrepresentation of the essential values of religion, for distorting the essential message of religion. And therefore, in fact, when I mentioned earlier that at times he is also considered to be the Luther of Hinduism, because the way Martin Luther in fact tried to reform Christianity, the same way Rammohun is credited for basically reforming Hinduism. Now, of course, this Enlightenment thought of Roy is quite significant. I told you that Renaissance, Reformation and Enlightenment, the three important developments in modern history, both in Europe and elsewhere, significant for understanding the beginning of a modern era in human history. And in Indian context, this Enlightenment, one can say, came of course with this period, particularly when this type of awareness dawned on the people that it is not the blind faith, but it is the reason which has to be privileged in human life. For example, in the kind of orthodoxy, the kind of conventional wisdom, the kind of things which were being done in name of conventions, in name of religion, in name of culture, were questioned. And therefore, this significance of reason, or basically the priority which was assigned to reason, was important moment in the life of the Indian people, in the life of Indian society. And particularly this question of utility, that which is very significant for Enlightenment thought, both in India and elsewhere, that how human beings should approach a particular reality, how human beings should look at anything social, political or religious. It's basically human beings should approach it from the point of view of utility, whether it is useful or not. If it is useful from the point of view of human needs, social needs, human life, human values, then it is to be adopted. If it is not useful, then it has to be discarded. And therefore, this reason and utility became the two important tools through which this Enlightenment thought surfaced, not only in India, but elsewhere as well. And Rammohun also operationalized these two tools, the reason and utility, in basically giving the firm basis for this Enlightenment sensibility to the Indian people. Now, in Tuhafatul piece, which I have already mentioned, the first important piece written by Rammohun, he argues that every individual has an innate and natural faculty to know the truth and falsity of the various religion, and without instrumentality of prophet, without the instrumentality of authority, and without any faith in traditional revelation. And therefore, because human beings have this innate facility for this truth, to know this truth, understand this truth, therefore that innate facility has to be cultivated and developed in each human being. And if it is done, then naturally the monopoly of the priestly class will disappear. And then most of the distortions which have crept into religion would also get diminished and mitigated. And therefore, human life will be liberated, where human beings could enjoy their freedom and their liberty. So this is how he looked at this Enlightenment thought, and this is how he looked at this entire sensibility. Of course, Rammohun, so far his social and social and religious thought is concerned, or his reform is concerned, he adopted three approaches, and these three approaches are very significant for social religious reform movement from for India. The first was that exposing and discrediting the religious dogmas and the practices, particularly those which were irrational and contrary to the social comfort. The second approach was, the second approach was promotion of modern Western education, because he believed that traditional education in India was responsible for basically patronizing and supporting most of these practices. Particularly, we will come to this issue, that when he pleaded for modern English education, he believed that all the texts which are available in Indian libraries of Sanskrit, Persian and Arabic should be simply thrown out, because no good can happen to mind or society by reading these texts, because now it is the time that Indian people should be exposed to modern ideas of philosophy, of science, of technology, of chemistry, of astronomy, in all the modern branches of knowledge which have happened after the scientific revolution. And only with that knowledge human beings can make progress. So this is how Rammohun basically considered education as an important tool for this reform, because he believed that if this modern education is given to the people, they will move away from this orthodoxy and conventional wisdom. And finally, the third important approach was that state action in support of these programs, that these programs cannot move at their own. They have to be supported by legislation. They have to be supported by law. They have to be supported by state, initiative. Then only, these reform initiatives can be successful. So therefore, three-pronged approach of Rammohun for social and religious reform is quite significant, which became the basis for his subsequent crusade against many such practices in India. Case of Rammohun's political thought, social and the religious issues become quite prominent, particularly in terms of his diagnosis of all the evils which were afflicting Indian society during his time. And therefore, any study or any analysis of Rammohun's political thought has to start with understanding of his social and religious thought, that what was his take on society, what was his take on religion. In fact, as we have seen, that Rammohun considered three important approach, three important tools for basically taking his entire project ahead. And they were, the modern education, they were the kind of exposing and discrediting the religious dogmas. And finally, he also considered state support, a state initiative, law, legislation as important tool. Of course, on issues of these reforms, particularly on education, the approach of Rammohun was different from many of his contemporaries, including Radhakant Dev of Bengal, because he believed that education, he was also a great votary of modern English education, but he believed that this education was necessary for the advancement of the career of Indian people, for the Indian student, the youth, and so on and so forth, because they could get jobs and placements under the British East India Company or the British rule. But Rammohun's approach was different. It was not for the career advancement only. It was not only for getting a better job, but it was for creating or, you know, rekindling a kind of scientific spirit in people. It is, was meant to basically enlighten people's mind, and therefore he had a more broader, more holistic approach to education. In fact, one can say that subsequently what is associated with Macaulay and his critiques for that, that he basically wanted to bring English education in India in order to create the subordinate employees for the East India Company, clerks, PMs and so on and so forth, because it was not possible for the Britishers to come and run such a mammoth machine. But that apart, in fact, his critiques for that, many nationalist critiques for bringing English education and turning Indian people into servitude. Macaulay's and Dev approach, Radhakant Dev's approach can be compared here. But that is not true with Rammohun. In fact, Rammohun at times is also criticized for supporting modern English education. But one has to go deeper into the reasons that why he pleaded for it, why he basically campaigned for it. We will take up this issue, education, a little later. But one thing is very important. In fact, at that time when we wanted Britishers to actively intervene in the social and, political process, when we wanted British rule in India to show active interest in social reform and religious reform, it didn't go down well with the conservatives. Because the conservatives in India were, firmly opposed to this idea of British intervention in social and religious practices, the customary moorings of Indian society. Rather, they wanted the Britishers to keep their hands off these matters, which they did for many, many years. It was only later that, British rule in India abandoned its neutrality and started interfering actively on account of a different discourse which surfaced both in England as well as in India, and this debate, as it is well known, between the Anglicists and the Orientalists, that the Anglicists argue that as an empire, Britishers also have a responsibility to discharge towards Indian people, and that responsibility would amount to this active interference in Indian society. Britishers cannot keep their hands off all the social religious matters and leave these evil practices to continue and the Indian people to get degraded. So that was the kind of position Anglicists were taking. Orientalists among the Europe as well as among the British administrators, they believed that Indian people, Indian culture, Indian tradition, they are museum material and they should be left alone. There shouldn't be any tinkering with it. There shouldn't be any interference with this. Rather, they should be allowed to have the kind of autonomy they have enjoyed since ages. And therefore, basically, British rule would do well if it doesn't interfere in these matters. But finally, Anglicists had the way, and then there were series of legislations, including the banning of Shati. So, Rammohun, therefore, was opposed to this conservative view, both among the Indian people, Indian opinion, as well as among the British administrators. He wanted Britishers not only to legislate, but to actively, basically, participate in this entire reform initiative. Rammohun, therefore, pioneered a movement for state intervention, in reforms. Now, Rammohun, of course, interestingly, was not only opposed by the orthodox opinion. He was not only opposed by the traditionalists. He was not only opposed by many orthodox upper castes, the Brahmins, priests, who believed that he was basically indulging in an act which ultimately led to the erosion of Hinduism and its scriptures. But in fact, he was also opposed by some young radicals in Bengal, like Darozio, who himself was a radical in his approach. But he thought that Rammohun's entire initiative, Rammohun's entire approach was half-baked. He was half-liberal. Rammohun was half-liberal in the opinion of Darozio, and therefore, he believed that he was being an opportunist when he tried to combine or synthesize Vedas, Qurans and Bible and therefore didn't speak against religion, but only spoke against the evil practices of religion. And therefore, there is your belief that he was totally being dishonest. Rather, you know, he was being opportunist in trying to synthesize these things instead of offering a more, you know, trenchant and radical critique of religion, which he believed, you know, was the requirement of the time. So, therefore, we find that Rammohun had to basically struggle against both types of opinion, coming from the radicals like Derozio and also from people like, you know, Dev, which I have already seen that how Radhakant, Dev and others had different approach on education, on religion, on society and on so on and so forth. Now, coming to this question of religion, which is very significant in context of Rammohun's thought. In fact, as I mentioned earlier also, he did a comparative study of religion. And he studied four religions. In fact, interestingly, not only Hinduism and Islam, but he also studied Christianity. He also studied Buddhism, particularly after his estrangement with his father when he left home and took to wanderings. He went to Tibet, and it is here that he picked up his knowledge and understanding of Buddhism. Now, on basis of his comparative study of religion, what we find that Rammohun highlighted the three basic tenets of religion. First, the belief in the universal supreme being, that all religions stand for supreme universal being. The second, the belief in existence of soul. And the third, that every religion talks of life after death. But he at the same time, on basis of his comparative study, attacked dogmas. And he basically thought that there should not be any compromise on the issue of dogmas, because these dogmas are the responsible for the degradation of human race. Now, he not only attacked dogmas, but he also attacked basically polytheism. In fact, polytheism and idolatry, because these two things he singled out to be the basis or the cause of all the evil practices in the religion. Not only in Hinduism, of course, Hinduism for him was the notable case of this polytheism, worshipping many gods or the idol worship. And therefore, in fact, he was attracted towards Islamic monotheism, believing in one God. In fact, he also thought that Indian Vedant also preached monotheism, but it was gradually it got submerged into this polytheist practices and polytheist thinking. Now, in fact, a thinker like Zemi Bentham, he also endorsed Rammohun's entire initiative or his entire crusade against idolatry. And when he wrote a very laudatory letter to Rammohun saying that you have cast off 35 million of gods and by using reason in religion. So you have cast off 35 million of gods, that so many gods and kind of idolatry practice and kind of polytheism which was in vogue, you have countered all of them. So therefore, he endorsed his initiative. In fact, later we find that Vivekanand, Tagore, Gandhi, the all other and many other nationalist icons, nationalist leaders who also believed in social and religious reform in India, they basically endorsed Rammohun's entire thought on the unity of religion, that how all religions are united at one plane. All of them have similar message. Of course, the roots are different. And therefore, one can see the significance of Rammohun's thought on religion from the point of view of 19th century India. Now, before we move further, we have to see that on what ground Rammohun opposed polytheism. Basically, he opposed polytheism or idol worship on three important grounds. The first is anthropomorphic conception of one supreme being. The second was, of course, not from the sense of duty, because from the point of view of worldly rewards, that people go to different gods, to go to such practices, not from the point of view of duty, but from the point of view rewards. So therefore, there is a selfish interest. And the third was that the rituals which are associated with such practices do not give morality. Rather, it comes from, the morality can come from spirituality, for which this idol worship is not required at all. So therefore, in fact, he was for moral norms and morality codes of Hinduism and Christianity. That's why I mentioned that he considered, the Sermon on the Mount, that tract of Christianity to be the most important tract, because it talks of morality and, values. It talks of ethics. Rather, in fact, he rejected the divinity of Christ, but he admitted his moral teachings, particularly the Sermon on the Mount. And therefore, in fact, one can see that his religious thought was basically expressed as early as 1820, so far as the Christianity is concerned, particularly when he wrote that famous tract called Precepts of Jesus, A Guide to Peace and Happiness. And when he, turned to Christianity, he particularly took on this Trinitarian Christianity, because he believed that Christianity is also suffering from the same vices which are basically plaguing Hinduism and other religion. And therefore, what Rammohun was trying to do at that time was to highlight another dimension of Christianity, that is Unitarian discourse within Christianity. He rejected Christian doctrine of Trinitarian God. He, in 1821, he in fact supported the founding of Calcutta Unitarian Committee and also became a member. Not only himself, but he also persuaded his son to become a member of this Unitarian Committee. But there are certain misconceptions about Rammohun. Many people believe that he became a convert to Christianity. He converted to Christianity, but that is not true. Because one can see some of his exchanges, because when he was declared by the bishop, or rather he was praised by the bishop for converting to Christianity, Rammohun said that, I have not laid down one superstition to take up another. So therefore, he believed that all religions are same and one doesn't have to convert. The only thing is to reform these religions. At one plane, he believed that Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism have the similar message. So this is how we can see that how profound his ideas and thought were on religion, both Hinduism, Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, and that's why his comparative study of religion was quite significant. Now, coming to the next issue, which is also significant in his political thought, is the women issues, the degradation of women in India. And it is here that some of the things which he picked up for reform become quite important. And the three, four important things which can be seen here in thought of Rammohun, so far as the women's upliftment in India is concerned. One is the system of sati, and another is the widow remarriage. The third is the female education, and the fourth is property rights, giving property rights to women in India. Now, before I take up these issues, I should mention here one thing, that a lot of people who believe that Rammohun thought basically, struggles in establishing its credential as a nationalist thought because he endorsed British rule in India, should also remember that what was the basis of colonial rule, the moral basis or the justification of colonial rule in India. In fact, when this entire colonial rule was crafted, its legitimacy, the ideological legitimacy, was given by two issues, the caste and woman. They were written on their entire discourse, on their flag, because the caste practices and degradation of women, these were the two issues on basis of which they believed that Indian people were not civilized and they required civilization. And only an external rule like the British rule in India could basically put them on the path of progress. This is how, the great British thinker James Mill and his son John Stuart Mill basically argued through their writings. So therefore, women and caste were the important issues. And we find, of course, there is some silences in Rammohun's political thought on the issue of caste. But he took this woman issue, you know, upfront. Of course, on the caste issue, he believed that the Indian disunity is largely on account of caste system. But he didn't take up this issue the way perhaps he took up many other social issues. For example, you know, a lot of critics who believe that he continued to believe in caste practices as upper caste person, he believed in the caste practices. He didn't take them in the same with the same zeal as he took up other social issues like woman issue and the religious issues. So therefore, this is there. But one thing is very significant, that how this woman issue became important for entire nationalist churning, for entire Indian identity, which later on surfaced in India. So therefore, this credit should definitely go to him for understanding its long-term implication for Indian subjugation, long-term implication for the loss of freedom which India had suffered at the hand of external forces. So therefore, this question of sati. Now, 1829, as all of us know, that sati was abolished by William Bentinck, in India, by an act, by legislating on this issue, and how this issue led to a kind of heated exchange between those who wanted change in Indian society and those who wanted a status quo, between the orthodox opinion, between the conservative elements of society and those who stood for change, those who stood for transformation. And Rammohun held his ground on basis of the scriptures of Hinduism. He not only proved but rather established that this practice was against the spirit of religion. Hinduism as a religion doesn't endorse it. This is a distortion which crept into this entire discourse later, and therefore convinced not only Britishers but also convinced the Indian people that how they have to move away from this practice if there is any hope, any possibility of any progress left for them. So therefore, this entire sati, abolition of sati, is quite important. I mentioned in my lecture earlier that he sailed to England in 1830 largely to defend this entire move, because there was a kind of attempt to nullify this legislation in order to pacify the conservative elements and the conservative opinion in India. And he went there to defend this legislation and to convince and persuade the Britishers, the British rule, the rulers, the king, that such nullifications attempt should be dropped forthwith, because it would basically a kind of a sin they would be indulging in. So this is how we have to see this abolition of sati. Now, similarly, there is another important issue which is also associated with him, that is widow remarriage. Of course, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, another great social reformer of Bengal, he in fact took this matter to greater height. But it was Rammohun who also emphasized this widow remarriage, because he thought that because of practice of early marriage, the child marriage, and because of this widowhood, it was rampant in the society, and therefore it amounted to degradation of women. But in order to achieve these ends, Rammohun believed that the most important thing was the female education. Unless females are educated, they cannot come to their own, and these practices cannot be ended or cannot be completely eradicated forever. So therefore, female education he highlighted and prioritized and gave importance, and particularly when he talked of sati, and he also basically singled out Christianity here. He said that the kind of doctrine of atonement, which is basically in Christianity, the similar doctrine of atonement associated with sati, that for your last past life you have to atone in this life, this is a basically fallacious assumption, and therefore these practices of all religions have to be discarded. So therefore, this is how we can say that female education became a tool in his hands for these initiatives. Of course, he also fought for the woman's right to property, because this is how he believed that equality could be brought in the society between men and women. And when he talked of attacked polygamy and child marriage, it was essentially meant to end these practices of widowhood and other similar things. Of course, as I have mentioned, that on caste there is some ambivalences in his thought. In fact, a lot of critics believe that he believed in the caste practices, but nonetheless, the kind of disunity of Indian society he is attributed to caste system is to be taken note of. The next important issue is the education, modern education in India. As I mentioned in the very beginning of my lecture, that when people call him the maker of modern India, or when he call him the father of modern India, there are many reasons for that. But one important reason is, of course, the modern English education in India, which came here in 1835 with Macaulay's Minutes. But this important letter which he wrote to Lord Amherst in 1829 became the basis of this Macaulay's Minutes to great extent. In fact, in this letter, Rammohun clearly categorically stated that this education which is being imparted in India to people in Persian, Arabic and Sanskrit, no good can happen either to mind or to society. Even the two racks are left in liability for these books, it will be a liability, and therefore immediately this will be dispensed with. And the Britishers should discharge their responsibility towards Indians by giving the same education which they have got in their home native country. So this is how he pleaded for modern English education. In fact, there are some scholars who argue that there was a trade-off between power and knowledge. In fact, in Rammohun's thought, Rammohun argued that you give us knowledge, we give you power. Because this is how, they use, the postmodernist Foucaultian frame to see the trade-off between power and knowledge in India taking place with Rammohun. But nonetheless, this is a very significant contribution of Rammohun's in Indian political thought. Of course, in the later years when the national movement in India started, and the entire opinion got divided between those who attacked this modern English education and those who supported it, including Gandhi, who in his Hind Swaraj gave a trenchant critique of Western civilization and Western modernity. And even before Gandhi, we have had the Swadeshi movement and the militant nationalist movement like Tilak, Lala Lajpat Rai, Bipin Chandra Pal, Aurobindo. They also believed that this was the beginning of the enslavement of mind, because modern English, earlier India had lost only political and economic freedom, but now India also lost, intellectual autonomy and intellectual freedom. So there is a debate on this issue. We don't have time to go into all these issues, that how this Anglicist and Orientalist was the first round of debate or whether this modern English education should be introduced in India or not. And the Orientalists believe that Indians should be given full autonomy to have their own knowledge, own education, own culture, everything. We should not disturb it. But Anglicists wanted to discharge their imperial responsibility by making these changes. Finally, Anglicists had its way, and Macaulay was one such Anglicist. But it was Rammohun who basically laid the foundation of this entire initiative. But later on, when national movement was at its peak, again the opinion got divided between the two camps, and the debate continues till now. Now, after this education, we have to see the political ideas of Rammohun, and they are equally important. As a believer in Western modernity, he believed in rule of law. He studied diocese, particularly that made him a firm believer in rule of law. In fact, he believed in separation of power, and that's why he didn't want, Indian Legislative Council to legislate in India. He wanted the entire act to be done in Britain, because he thought that the separation of power doctrine would be disturbed, because governors would be both executor and legislator of this entire thing. He was also a firm believer in freedom of press. Rather, he was a firm believer of civil rights, the political rights, civil rights, and particularly, the personal liberty. He wanted codification of laws, and he was also anti-monarchist in his thinking. He believed that equating God and king was not true. So therefore, we can see the political ideas are not different from his other ideas so far as enlightenment sensibility of Rammohun is concerned. He was heavily influenced by the Western developments in both political realm as well as intellectual realm. In economic thought, of course, there are certain ambivalences, because a lot of scholars believe that his liberal capitalist and feudal aristocratic values got combined, and therefore he was a son of a Zamindar and himself had a Zamindari interest, as well as he was also an investor in free trade. And therefore, when this debate cropped up in England between the free trade lobby and those who wanted East India Company to have monopoly, he sided with the free trade lobbies. So therefore, on economic thought, of course, a lot of people find fault with Rammohun's thought that it was not purely anti-colonial, anti-imperialist as it should be. Criticisms, we have seen that number of criticisms, Derogio we have seen, Radhakant Dev, and therefore many critics believe that why he supported freedom struggles in other countries but was silent in India. He basically supported, Naples, when the Austria basically troubled them, but didn't support India's national movement. But here one has to see that how he related Indian social degradation and the kind of progress which he saw only happening with the help of the British colonial rule, because they represented a better civilizational values. In conclusion, we can say that he was maker of modern India, and the caste and women, which are the markers of India's degeneration, Rammohun took up head on.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. And dear friends, we believe that if you have liked our today's lecture, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in, and all the questions pertaining to the lecture could also be asked and could be communicated on the same ID, that is info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.